This is a panel entitled originally Progressive Satirical Activism. But you know, I don't use the word progressive anymore, so I made a mistake putting that word in there because progressive to me is like liberal. I don't use it anymore. Bill de Blasio is a progressive, you know. Andrew Cuomo is a progressive. O'Malley is a progressive. So conservative Democrats have now taken the word progressive. And they'll be taking the word left soon. So I think we'll all be calling ourselves the Revolutionary Communist Party. RCP. The RCP, which I think is satirical activism as well. Because obviously, they're not looking to expand their base for that. Revolutionary Communist Party in 2015. I have a lot of friends here. I got arrested for this guy a few times. At any rate, so we're going to just call this satirical activism. What it is, I don't know. All right? Satirical activism. I put this panel together. I said, all right, what are we going to do? Something about, you know, using comedy, using the satire to burlesque the system in all walks of life. Well, we got Paul Krasner, who, you know, his great work back in the 60s, 70s. He did The Realist up to 2002, and he was one of those yippies that was part of everything back then. And we'll talk about that. You can ask him questions. We've got a lot of time to burn this, so don't worry about asking questions. And let me just introduce you to this panel. This is Giuliana Ferlani. You might know her from WBA Rally. She's got a show on WBAI every night at 6 p.m. She's a satirist. She's a comedian. And she had a couple of panels already. She hosted a comedy show yesterday. This is John McDonough. You know John McDonough from also from WBAI. He's got a show every Saturday called "They're Not Fundraising Mode," which means he's on twice a year Saturday. In between shows. We got it on next one. So Radio Free Aaron and John and I have done a lot. He's an activist. He's a satirist. He's a prankster. He's perfect for this panel. And then we have Lionel. I don't know if you know Lionel. Lionel is a well-known satirist, a comedian, he's an analyst, he's a conspiracy nut, and
I'm not a nut.
No, I'm a nut, but not a conspiracy nut. They called Paul Krasner, by the way, the FBI called him unconfined nothing. So you may have seen Lionel doing very, very good incisive trenchant analysis, satirical analysis on WPIX. So he's a wordsmith and used to be with Good Morning America. He's got a really solid record. We're not all. So I'll give him a round of applause. So why don't you say a few things about your past, Julia?
My past? I don't know.
About your life. About, just give us just like an encapsulation. And I'm not going to be the complete chair of this. And ask questions. I don't have questions. You ask questions.
Well, I host the show on WBAI, I'll just jump off from there, I guess. I don't know, do you really want to know about my past?
All right, no.
College, I don't know.
All right, that's enough. All right,
so.
Because there's 400 panels going on in this place, and they're all, it's like sitting Shiva in each one. The left is definitely bereft of a sense of humor. It's one thing. If I was born a right winger, I'd make a lot more money. Because they know how to laugh.
Can I say something? I couldn't sleep at all last night. I went to like three panels, and like all I could do was. And the comedy show, which was good, but the panels that I went to just basically kept me up all night. I went to the war one, the dead kids, and I went to, it was awful. maybe other people who are just like not paying attention.
So, and then,
I don't know if I can add to that, but I will tell you that the biggest illusion in the country is the left-right paradigm. That there's this significant difference between candidates, between the media left, the two sides of the same coin. There is nothing appreciably different between any of these people. Nothing. Nobody has a platform. Nobody has an idea. If you want to go on a progressive show, all you do is make fun of Fox. If you go on a Fox show, you can refer to the left as being anti-family or what have you. But there's intellectual torpor. There's creative morbidity. Nobody has a plan. And what I'm finding is that the greatest source of media today and information is going to be alternative and foreign. Nothing here. Today we announced Bob Schieffer retired. And I tweeted, because I love to tweet, Bob Schieffer. No hits, no runs, no errors. Bob Schieffer. Never made anybody upset, never covered anything, didn't steal anything. Nice guy. A sweet guy. Likes country music. My Uncle Chip's a nice guy. He doesn't have to do anything. So I'm just going to tell you right now, to walk around, telling my wife, to see somebody, especially younger people, give a damn about anyone is the most refreshing. I don't care. Communist, leftist, Marxist, nuke the whales, anything. The fact that you're actually sitting and can explain an ideology about anything instead of telling the world is the most refreshing thing. I'm serious. There's no such thing as any opinion that I find problematic, as long as you can enunciate it. That's it. And if that's satire, so be it. Because the news is satire.
Can't make it up, right?
So, and then we have John McDonough. John McDonough has been very, very, very active. We've done a lot of things together over the years, promoting various causes. Satirizing various issues. And John, why don't you just expand on that?
Well, just been at BAI a long time on Saturdays, but now I'm doing a show at Valley Food Court on Wednesdays, which I really enjoy because we're covering city politics. And what I'll be talking about later is getting into the critical vortex here in New York City of working on his political campaigns, and then some of the street theater that we've done. One of them was when Bernie Madoff was being sentenced down at Court Street. I called up Randy, and I said, well, let's go down and support Bernie Madoff. And this was our campaign. Clemency for the Ponzi won. So I'll explain about what happened down there, and that was pretty crazy. And then I'll tell the story about when Maggie Thatcher died. I organized an Irish wake in Brooklyn for her. It was packed and made worldwide news. And then I'll try and pull up on the thing my career at Fox Television, which lasted 1 minute and 50 seconds. And I organized, I'm a yellow cab driver for 35 years, I organized CAB, Cabbies Against Bush, during during that time, I offered a free ride to any Republican to Kennedy Airport that wanted to fight in Iraq. And I said, the one person I really wanted to take was Bill O'Reilly. I'll be showing him this draft dodging, you know, getting all the benefits of not going to Vietnam. He wanted to fight in Iraq. So I hope to show that little clip. But it's things like that, instead of doing, say, comedy in the comedy clubs, and just reaching that way to pay people. Randy and myself went into the street and became part of the story, or whatever the story was. We tried to find an angle, because the press is there. They're always looking for something different. I believe you hook up with Randy, we're going to give you something different. kind of what we come out with. So hopefully we'll be talking about that, just following in the footsteps of Abby Hoffman and Paul Krasner and doing that. So I'll be talking about that.
Want me to get Paul?
Yeah, go ahead and get Paul on. A friend of mine over here, Mark Cook, who I met in Nicaragua in 1986. I did the Tonight Show in 1984. Did it one time, that was it. And Bill Kunstler, who I became very close friends with, and ran his organization after a guy called William Kunstler on racial justice. Bill Kunstler, whenever I did a benefit with him for WBAI or Vets Against the War, whatever, Bill Kunstler would bring me up, but always would do the one joke that got me kicked off the Tonight Show, which was, didn't get me kicked off, but got me banned. We're talking about Jane Kirkpatrick. And I said, you look at her and analyze some of the things she says, you have to ask yourself seriously, did Eva Braun die in that bunker in 1998? That was it, you know? The next place I worked after that was in front of the U.S. Embassy in Managua, Nicaragua.
He used to do all
the crowds that would, I could ever get to like me back then. You know, what was really progressive? The Lower East Side, the Upper West Side, and U.S. Embassy in Managua. And I used to go in front of like 200, it was this crowd, I said it yesterday, it was basically this crowd standing in front of the U.S. Embassy on Thursday morning, 7 a.m., and there would be singers, there would be religious leaders, they were called Sandalistas, and I would do my reggae, and I did that, it became such a hit, and I did it for Daniel Ortega, I was invited to do Reagan for Ortega at a party. And you were there, you remember that? At the Rostina Bar. I got Paul in the line. I said, Thomas Borhey loved my act. I used to call the U.S. Embassy Bates Motel. Then I lost my passport down there. I had to go to the U.S. Embassy to get it renewed. And that was a real adventure.
Could I just say something on this?
Yes.
Randy would do these every Thursday morning. They were a huge hit. The U.S. Embassy, I lost my passport too, and I went there, and the guy who came out was a consul, and he wanted to talk for a little bit. He knew, see, I was a journalist, I had a journalist pass with my ID, and he said, you know, I got to say, an open mind. Of course, anybody from this Reagan administration in 1985 would have been sent to Nicaragua because he had an open mind. But what I've seen here with the Sandinistas is just, I'm not sure you want to cry. I mean, this is just horrible. They have 1,000% inflation rate. And I had my application in a couple of hands, so I couldn't sell the stuff. But I said, well, you know, that sounds bad, but Argentina has a 5,000% inflation rate, and Bolivia has a 25,000% inflation rate, and they didn't have a war. And it was clear that he was at CIA and was trying to recruit journalists. The following week, the Nicaraguan government arrested two functionaries from the Nicaraguan Interior Ministry who turned out to be both, and they had plenty of evidence against them, both CIA agents. They had a cigarette lighter that had a $25,000 cigarette lighter that had a camera.
Still have a funny ending.
Yeah, let's talk about
it. Randy pissed off these wonderful events. The guy who was
I got arrested down there, by the way. I got arrested in Nicaragua because I went to Enrique Schmidt police station with this passport that was missing a picture. So they arrested me and turned out to be a CIA agent. But the conditions there at that jail where I was for 24 hours, much better than any precinct that I've been in this city over the last 5 years. I've been arrested four times, and the precinct's much worse.
The one thing that Randy...
Oh, wait,
we'll get back on it. All right, we got to bring up Paul. Can you hear us?
I can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. So, Paul, this is Randy Credico with our panel. You got a packed room. What's that?
A packed room.
Yes. Will you see us?
No, you can't see
us. I just see a mountain.
Anyway, you look fantastic here. How do you look, folks? I got a feeling half of these people know you from back in the 60s. So,
yay.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about how you got involved in political satire? What brought you into it? You can encapsulate that for this audience. What got you to become a prankster? What is your problem?
Hello. Well, I guess it started when I was doing freelance articles for Mad Magazine. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. And the editor refused to publish a few things in Mad because he said it was for grown-ups. And so I went to the publisher and complained about it. And they had just reached 1.25 million subscribers to Mad. And I said to Bill Gaines, the publisher, I said, I guess you don't want to, because it was aimed for teenagers and preteens. And I said, I guess you don't want to change horses in midstream. And Bill Gaines said, not when a horse has a rocket up its ass. And so I realized that there was no satirical magazine for adults. And so, without going into the details, I launched The Realist in 1958. And Steve Allen was the first subscriber, and he sent a bunch of subscriptions to others, including Lenny Bruce. Lenny Bruce sent a bunch of subscriptions to his friends, and they went on and on, and it was like Malthusian growth without any advertising. It was just word of mouth, which is the best kind of advertising, and it's free. So,
the magazine was...
The what?
The Realist.
Oh, I said that. There's an echo of myself, so I thought you were repeating what I said, but that was me. So anyway, cartoonists started sending me, unsolicited, they would send cartoons, Radish would send articles. These cartoonists were from the New Yorker magazine, and some of their submissions were considered either too controversial or in bad taste. And the same thing with articles, that the mainstream magazine wouldn't do that. And so The Realist became a central place for people to publish, where they could get it published nowhere else. And so the satire came out to me it was a kind of alchemy to turn the horror and the hypocrisy and all of the absurdities that were taken seriously. And so that's how it got started. And then as a performer, as a stand-up satirist, I would speak in the guise of a lecture at campuses, and it worked. And there was hunger for grown-up satire. This was before Spy magazine, before National Lampoon, before Laugh-In, before Doonesbury. There was simply nothing like it. So I didn't have any competition, but I also had to make it up as I was going along, just like the rest of my life.
You're getting laugh breaks and applause breaks. I don't know if you can hear them, but I just wanted to, I'm Juliana Pilato, I'm on the panel, and I just want, because of the technology, I wanted to make sure you know that people are laughing and applauding.
Very funny.
Thank you, audience. I appreciate that. Applause.
It's too bad you can't see us. I think it would be better, but... any questions for Paul? Yes. I'm going to take questions from the audience, and then I'll repeat them to you.
Okay. First of all, I just want to say, whenever I don't like my parents, I like to invoke your name, so because they're like, oh, Paul Krasner, he's so cool.
Wait,
and like,
he can't hear you, right? So, here, why don't you just, just make it
quickly. Okay, you can just repeat the question.
Okay.
Hi there, sir. I just wanted to say that you are like the one thing that my parents and I agree on. Whenever I want to like my parents better or like their policies better, I always am like, what about that Paul Krasner? And they're like, oh yeah, Paul Krasner. Like, for a second, I'm like, you guys are pretty cool. And then I go ahead, but thank you for that. I want to know, should we trust people under 40? That's a good question.
Well, you know, you may have been an exception because a lot of parents did not like their offspring to see the realist. For example, I published the Disneyland Memorial Orgy poster. I still have on my website now a colored edition of it. And I always ask the people who sent for it, how did you learn of our website? And they always say, well, my mother tore the poster off the wall. And I always wanted to get one. So there was a lot, and they destroyed some of their issues, and they had to get a subscription at a friend's house or at a post office box. So the generation gap was not selling jeans, but later on, a lot of parents read their kids' issues and vice versa. So I heard from a 10-year-old who later told me that his father was a union organizer. And so he read his father's thing. And then lots of people were influenced by it, like The Simpsons, by Matt Groening. He started reading it when he was a preteen. It was very gratifying to influence people. And people like George Carlin, who said that he changed from, you know, doing his weatherman stuff and started talking about what he really felt and didn't want to, play Las Vegas. And he let his hair grow and a beard. And same thing with Lewis Black. He was about 13 when he first read The Realist. And he read my most notorious article, which was the parts left out of the Kennedy book. And it blew his mind. And he said it changed his life, and I still get that kind of feedback. And I didn't get any salary, but I got a lot of pleasure out of people saying that they thought they were crazy, and then they realized at least they weren't the only one.
Oh, you're getting applause and laughter. We have another question for you.
Hello.
Cool.
Yes. The Realist, as I said, started in 1958, and in 1974, I ran out of money and taboos. But 11 years later, in 1985, I got a little grant for $5,000, and I was able to launch it again newsletter format, and that lasted until the spring of 2001. So even though there was an 11-year hiatus, people just thought that they were very slow in getting their subscription.
Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. Oh, he asked about the meetings that influenced me. At that time, the two main ones were Lenny Bruce and Ward Sahl. And And then later on, you know, I there were other fans who were comedians, Barry Crimmins, Elaine Boozler, there were a whole group of comedians and musicians like Jerry Garcia and Country Joe and John Lennon were also fans of it. So that was fun, you know.
Well,
it wasn't that.
There's a line forming now, so here's
right. Before I forget, I just want to
bring a line forming up.
Questions.
A lot of people want to ask questions. The Chicago 7, Chicago 8 trial, what was your role there? What happened to you there?
About the trial?
Yes.
Oh, the Chicago trial, the conspiracy
role,
trial. That was the stage where I was a psychedelic macho, and I would, I would go on the subway train and just sit down during rush hour, or I was on the Tonight Show, not with Johnny Carson, but his guest host was, if that's not an oxymoron, his guest host was Orson Bean, who was my oldest friend, and he got me on that show, and I took acid for that, but I didn't tell him because I didn't want to make him uncomfortable. But I was peeking. I came out of the green room, and Ed McMahon, his sidekick, his face was melting down into his chest, and I was just kind of staring at him, and then my core of reality sent up a message to my subconscious saying, turn around and talk to Orson. And so I did, and I would, you know, at one point he said, now you've taken LSD, haven't you? And I thought for a good second, uh-oh, it's showing. And then my core of reality said, no, he's just asking about the past, how I've taken LSD. And then I said, yes. And the audience booed. And Larson asked me, he said, well, why do you think they're booing? And I just said, well, they're predisposed to people taking LSD.
Paula, we have two final questions for you. I'm sorry we have these two women here. Well, I'm not sorry. I'm thrilled. But so final questions.
Hi. So my question, Paul, is, where is the wedge in political satire today that can affect mobilization as the realists did in the 60s?
Oh, that's a good question because, when I started the magazine, I was, kind of alone in the forest. My slogan was, my only sacred cow is irreverence. But now irreverence has become an industry.
Yeah.
And so in the guise of satire, a lot of publications and comedians they use sarcasm, they use name calling, they use a lot of the four letter words that get a laugh, even though like Jon Stewart, you know, he'll say fucking so many times that you think he has no big vocabulary. And Lenny Bruce would be embarrassed about it. We made a point of never using that kind of language in order to get a laugh. But he was more a self-taught semanticist, as George Carlin was. What was the question again? So the wedge is between, it's like any other kind of humor. You know, there's good satire and bad satire. And so a lot of satire is just, easy shots and easy targets. And so there's a whole spectrum you know, there's Dolby satire, and there's brilliant satire, and it's just, it's all subjective. All humor is subjective, and so if two people can watch this, the same bit of satire, and one will think it's disgusting, and somebody else will think it's genius. So it's really totally subjective in the end.
All right, final question for Paul. Hi, Paul. It's Barbara Garson from the
Barbara Garson. Yeah. Hey, so glad to hear
you.
How
come you look just the same, and I have this white hair? Do
you have the
white? My eyes going better. Do you look just the same?
You should see the painting of me in the closet. If you remember, what's his name?
Dorian Gray.
I just had my birthday last month.
Happy birthday.
83. And so, inside I feel like I'm 23, but, you know, I use a walker to get from one room to another. So I don't travel anymore anywhere, which is why I'm not in New York now. And we're doing this by Skype, which it's all electronic magic to me. I'm going to have a new website called Luddite.com.
Paul, so
yes.
One of the questions was, gap between, go ahead.
Wedge.
Right now.
Let me compare it to how it was in the 60s, and then I'll bring it up to the present. Because in the 60s, the Yippies, the Youth International Party, I think that folk singer Phil Oakes, who was one of the original founders, he summed it up and he said, demonstration should turn you on, not turn you off. And so the Yippies, even before I had given them the name, did things like going to Wall Street with 200 dog singles, and at first they wouldn't let a bunch of hippies in until Abby said, "We're Jewish, we're going to have to tell the Anti-Defamation League." and so they let us in, and we went up on the balcony, and at one point threw down onto the floor of the stock exchange these singles, and they went crazy downstairs. They weren't used to seeing actual money. Stock market was so abstract. And so they suddenly morphed from yelling out, "Pork barrels, pork bellies." And instead, it changed into diving for dollars. And all the activity stopped there. So this was the prank, but the truth behind the prank was that the reporters were waiting outside the stock market, and so then we could discuss the reasons for us going in to call attention to the connection between Wall Street and the Vietnam War, and then to jump from that to several decades later, the Occupy movement used humor to make some of their points, and it was inspiring. So there was a sense of continuity. Other things we did there was, for example, Jim Ferret, who was one of the early gay activists, was also a Yippie, and he suggested that we do that thing at the New York Stock Exchange. Abby Hoffman had another idea, and he had a press conference at his apartment with his wife Anita, and it was to announce the birth of Lace, which was supposedly a combination of LSD and DMSO. And so, if you would, and it was really it was just Schwartz's a spray of a novelty. Taiwan of you spray something on and it would look purple and then it would fade into your skin. So it was just a novelty item. But nobody said that. And so this it was Lace, just a variation on mace. And so it was told that if you got sprayed with Lace, it would serve as an instant aphrodisiac, and whoever got sprayed on it, and then they had
three mattresses. Drugs that actually do that, for real. Which are illegal.
Oh yeah, but legal now. But then they had a few couples get sprayed with the Lace, and they would and they had a few mattresses on the floor of their living room. And they would begin to disrobe and start making love on these mattresses. Now, Abby wanted me to be there as a reporter, and I would be standing next to, supposedly, to a lovely red-headed hippie, and she and I were supposed to be accidentally sprayed with it, and I would put my pad down and pen, except that and I agreed to do it, and I was kind of excited, you know. Even though it was the height of the sexual revolution, there was some kind of cheap thrill knowing in advance that you were going to get laid. But then when I got home and checked my calendar, I realized that there was a problem, because I was committed to go to a writer's conference in Iowa at the university.
Oh.
And so I told Abby I couldn't do it, and he said, okay, well look, there's a lot of farmland out there. Why don't you go, we want to have, they were already planning for October 1967, yes.
I'm sorry to have to cut you off, but we're running a little short on time for the conversation that was planned, but it has been, I am conveying the thoughts and feelings of the audience. It's been an absolute honor to have you join us on the panel today. So everyone, please.
Thanks for having me.
Well, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Where can we find this material?
So where can we find
Allcrasner.com with two S's.
Allcrasner.com.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Paul.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that was awesome.
That was great. Did this at Pace University, you would have better equipment, all right? And not with the NYPD floating around like we are here. I thought it was because it's a Black Lives Matter conference that the police are. They're regular here, right? The NYPD is always
justice, criminal justice school.
Yes. No, but you're not at private universities, only at the City College and State College, right? Or City College.
So I think I would like to make a point that actually came up in terms of like where to find. So, I think the issue is, I think people feel frustrated maybe because in the past these the realists and things, they came out and they sort of came to you in some way, and these days having, and Randy can probably speak to this as well, but once you start doing political material, you are not welcome in the clubs, you are not welcome on TV, you are not welcome anywhere. So the fact that Left Forum even has a, you know, like invite, there are a bunch of really cutting satirical comedians and, you know, up and coming people who are just doing the same old shtick, who are always looking for places to come and perform, to have their writing, you know, out there, spoken. It's not, there is still a vibrant political
center. Where are you going to go? You're going to go to some, let's say,
Left Forum comedy show.
Biloxi, Mississippi, and have a sign, left wing comedy. Who's going to pay to see that? Nobody is going, commercially it doesn't work. Yeah, if you were down there, 3 or 4 people might show up, and both of them work for the Mississippi State Police. So it's very difficult to sell it as a commodity. You know, Jon Stewart is considered a left-wing comic. He reads material. He reads material that's written for him. Chris Hedges said that his type of humor kind of cheapens the entire, this, he trivializes a lot of serious issues. That's his opinion. Him and Bill Maher, they trivialized. If they were really making an impact, they wouldn't be on those shows, trust me.
Right.
If they were really radical, if they really had a left-wing view, they would not be on television, supported by commercial So if you have an opinion, if you're a serious satirist and trying to make change, I think everybody here is interested in making change. Like I said, I was on the Tonight Show. I've been arrested many times. Many times I've been arrested. Like I said yesterday, I've been booked more times in jail than I have in comedy clubs in the last 4 years. I ran for office last year against Governor Cuomo, and it was all satire. That was really satirizing. I knew I wasn't going to win. There were issues I wanted to bring up. I know the electoral process is not going to make a change. A lot of people think it's the electoral process. You got to change people. You got to get people on this. You got to have a movement. And how do you get a movement going? The only way I can, I'm not going to pick up arms and fight the government. So the best thing I can do is, since I'm going to be censored from television, is to try to do things on the street. You know, and one of the ways I do it is through satire on the street. Up in Albany a couple of years ago, I went up to Albany dressed up by the original satirist, the most effective satirist of his time, the father of satire, and that was Diogenes, the Greek philosopher. So Diogenes back then went door to door in the daytime with a lamp looking for an honest man in Athens, 500 BC. And so I went to Albany in 2009 dressed up as Diogenes looking for an honest politician. And that video went all over the world. It was on Greek television, it was on Spanish TV, and I think we got a picture of it dressed up with a Diogenes. I got thrown out because I had a gas lamp.
I actually have a hard time because, I started doing regular comedy, and then I was like, I feel awful because what gets you pushed ahead is, especially for a woman, like, kind of saying I'm a whore. That's basically what makes you move forward and get bookings and move, and talking about kind of gross, disgusting things. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm old fashioned. I'm not anti talking about sex, but I'm anti sort of putting a woman down and talking about all this disgusting stuff. So I started moving into political humor, and there was no space. You'd get less and less bookings. So I took to YouTube. Now the problem, which was great, sort of. The problem with YouTube is you guys aren't watching, or at least you weren't when I was on it, you know, so many years ago. The audience for YouTube and the audience for online stuff, they aren't accustomed to political satire. They're accustomed to cats taking a poo and, you know, stuff like that. They're not really accustomed to something like, you know, you can see the old work. It's called Absurdity Today. It's on YouTube. You can look. And, which is fun. And we might, if you listen to our show, that absurd minute that we do where we do the rapid fire jokes, that's, it used to be a video, which is how I got onto WBAI in the first place. But it's not, you know, it's, I forgot what I was going to say. That happens. But it just felt like, you know, you can't really move ahead in that field. You can't really move ahead in the entertainment industry just by doing this. And as a woman, forget it. The person who's doing the most cutting edge, like, feminist stuff, I've seen her stuff. I'm not going to name any names. She was really disgusting in that same way to move forward. And she also has a very famous relative. So it's kind of like, that's how that works. So I don't really know how people jump the barrier between becoming like a WBAI.
I really hate Chuck Schumer.
Oh,
I ran against him as well.
She's very nice. She does, you know, and now she's actually doing
By the way,
I...
some people do watch YouTube. Webster Tarpley is in the audience. A lot of people watch his show.
So that's on YouTube.
Hi. Well, but that's the, you know, that's the thing, and she's actually doing one of the things that I always hoped that one that I thought Sarah Silverman might do, which is get that level of fame and then jump over
like Paul Robeson
and do some of this more edgy political stuff. So it's kind of awesome, but it's also kind of, you know, hard to watch.
In 1988, I started to call, actually well before that, started to call talk radio shows as a joke. This is right around when Rush Limbaugh started, when talk radio was local, when it was about, we're going to get this street fixed, and it was just not anything. Which, by the way, was great. So I called up one day, and I realized that if I called up using different accents, I could be on 12 times a day using their equipment. I did this. And I had three rules of talk radio. Remember, this is before talk radio. This was really, this is 81, maybe, whatever, who knows? So the first rule was be the first caller. And I called up, anybody wants to do, try this, it works. Be the first caller and set the tone. I always start by saying, love your show. This is the greatest show I've ever had in my life. Part of my life, can I come on? Yeah, oh, you're next. Really? I love this guy. Rule number two, never talk about the subject. Whatever you're talking about. And number three, when at all possible, insult the host family. That's what I did. And kick the guy off for 3 hours. You know, ruin his day. I was never able to regroup, so I started to do it. In the car. I lost the race to say, would you like to come on the show and try doing your show on the weekend? I said, you bet. This was October of 88. I was actually practicing law at the time. I said, I don't want to, I keep up with the name Lionel, and I just saw a movie. I just picked that one name out of the sky, and it just stuck. So as I became doing the show, I said, I'm going to show these people satire. Problem is, nobody understands what satire means. You don't understand what it means. So I said one time, two things that were the most, this showed me the end of civilization as we know. First question was, how many people would you allow to be erroneously, incorrectly executed before you demand either an abolition or a moratorium to the death penalty? Give me a number. And I thought, this is hysterical. But the number, of course, is zero. I got four. Four tops. And I realized, this, I don't think, I thought it was me. The other one, which I will never forget in my life, I said, I'm going to take a position that I think is so ridiculous that they will obviously say, this was in 88, and you know, this was then. And I said, the Eighth Amendment says cruel and unusual punishment is prohibited by the Bill of Rights, and if you can kill somebody, execute, state sponsor, murder, if that is okay, then something short of death must be appropriate, must be allowable, therefore, torture must be acceptable. And people said, you're out of your mind. And I said, no, you don't understand it. Soldering iron, axle grease, I can't put these imagery, I don't even know what you're saying. In 1989, they said, you're out of your mind. Cut to today. Alan Dershowitz, talking about limited warrants for torture. Where you go to a tribunal, a FISA court for torture. Now, who's the satirist? There is no satire. Because we live in a world, you know, there was something very quick, you know, I used to enjoy, but I was a psych major. We used to go to psychiatric hospitals for, you know, and the first day I was there, somebody said, now, let me tell you something right now. Do not engage these people in their own psychosis. Do not try to reason with them. They will. One day, somebody in our class or group, somebody came over and said, see this? He had a high school ring. He said, I'm Kate. This poor woman, bless her heart, said, she had a ring because she was, I guess I'm the queen.
He stormed off. Thought about it for about a week. Came back later and says, you know, I'm the king. I don't have a queen. Broke every bone in her face.
That's today. There is no humor.
If
you try doing satire today, you try to say something pre Bernie Madoff, pre Bernie Madoff to Joe. This is a psych ward we live in. With all due respect to people in psych ward, there is no satire. You don't engage people. There's no humor. Nobody gets it. Nobody understands the absolute horrors of what we're seeing. Nobody, there is no humor. And somebody said it best. The F-bomb, or just as cruel, coarse, and scabrous, and caprolalic as anybody else, we're all like that. But when it's a substitution for wit, or an attempt to, that misses the point. Lee Paul said it best. Lenny Bruce never said this. Lenny Bruce listened to the stuff that got him arrested. It was nothing. And John Stewart, God bless him and his money. When we've got three writers, and every other word is an F-bomb, and people are laughing because it's, quote, hilarious, epic, or what have you, this is the problem today. So satire, this may be the death knell of satire. Not because satire is dead, but the people who are able to appreciate it, like those that you don't engage in a mental hospital, they don't get it. You don't engage people in satire because you have to be able to understand what humor even is. There you go.
Would you engage the Charlie Hebdo situation, and would that be possible?
Which one of us?
Oh,
let's go
ahead.
I told you, I consider it Lenny Wiesenthal type of humor. Okay, Charlie Hebdo is not responsible for political humor.
You mean Riefenstahl?
Wiesenthal, I'm sorry.
Simon Wiesenthal.
Simon.
Well, did I say? Well, put them together in there.
They're making fun of people who are already oppressed in France. You don't do that. I mean, it's the same as like taking a Jew in Germany and making his nose this big. You know, making the Mohammed, the faces that they use was so crass. And I found it to be very, very racist. Anti-Muslim, as I said, incendiary, irresponsible. I don't consider that. I don't consider it humor. I don't. It's like worse than like frat humor, the Charlie Hebdo situation. I don't know how they feel about it. A lot of my friends went to bat for them. You know, a lot of the world leaders went over there and went to bat for them. I'm sorry that they got killed, but you know, Muslims are under attack there in France and around the world as well. Look what we've created, that's a whole different story.
They would say it's a leftist.
Huh? They were not leftists.
No, it's a leftist.
You think it's a leftist magazine? I didn't consider it leftist.
In the overall production of Charlie Hebdo, they laugh at every single idea that you're just picking one aspect that has transpired into the US situation. That's why I want to get your take on this.
Oh, okay, wait a second.
I would just point out, Charlie Hebdo descends from Vichy fascists who were haters of de Gaulle, and they were funded then by the CIA to create this thing. The other thing I would point out is, I think it's a mistake to do the sociological analysis of this intelligence operation. And the point is, Hollande, the president of the country, had gone on television on Monday saying, sanctions against the Ukraine must, against Russia, over Ukraine must end. So no more sanctions against Russia over Ukraine. That was on Monday, and on Wednesday we have these events. So it's they're carried out by the usual suspects. In other words, the usual patsies kept by the DGSE and so forth. So I would not look at this as having anything to do with free speech, Mohammed, or anything. The point is that members of the French elite got killed in this operation. So this was a message from the CIA to the French government. Drop this, and indeed he did drop it. The sanctions are still in force.
An interesting point of view.
Giuliani and myself were at a fundraiser with Charlie Hebdo a couple of months ago, and I think to relegate guys sitting in a room with a pencil drawing cartoons and not liking their humor to be executed, Randy is out there, and a lot of people do not like what Randy Critico does from different points of view. But maybe a lot of people would like that.
To this show.
So I mean, it was
this
just
dying right up.
it was just that night you had the editor of Mad Magazine, The New Yorker, and who was the other one? The guy that did National Lampoon.
Oh yeah.
And they were describing, like, they do the same thing. If you've seen some of the cartoons that were in, say, National Lampoon or Mad or that, you can misconstrue it whichever way you're looking at it, but, you know, the penalty shouldn't be death, the cartoons.
Nobody thinks that.
Doing that.
I don't think
that. But the thing is, you should be allowed to do something somewhere around the world. I'm not saying.
I guess the Nazis.
The religion is
large and scope, and expect no response from the audience. To me, that was the Nazis marching Skokie 30 years ago.
I didn't see it that way. That's
my analysis. I found it very crass, very irresponsible. That's why.
Irresponsible.
Well, irresponsible. When you're going after an oppressed, take a look how Muslims live in Paris.
But they weren't, right? He wasn't drawing Muslims. He was
no,
drawing.
They've got, there's been Libya, Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq. How many hundreds of thousands of Muslims have been killed? Why keep pushing it?
It wasn't funny. What was funny about it? It was not satire. What the hell was it funny about it?
Well, the way I saw it, which could be totally wrong, just the way I saw it, is that the cartoons were usually against the heads of religions. And religions are oppressive forces around the world. I think that could be something that we all agree on. Maybe at least here in left form. And so, therefore, I didn't see, now I could be wrong, but I didn't see it as making fun of Muslims. I saw it as making fun of the hierarchy that keeps people,
The Canal and Chanet, the other French humor magazine, when the Pope, the Cardinal of Paris, died in a whorehouse, and it was said that he had been carried into the, he collapsed in the street of a heart attack.
Oh, yeah, sure.
He said he was carried into the whorehouse and laid in the bed because the poor, well, what was he doing on that street, the Canal and Chanet had? It's a red light district for hand to hand. Oh, well, he was ministering to fallen women. Oh, well, isn't that a bit, usually a parish priest would do that. I mean, it's important to keep your hand in. That is funny. I mean, that both because it actually happened and that was all very funny. But this thing
about sometimes satire isn't about being funny. It's about putting a mirror up to oppression. It's not always about making you chuckle.
I was just wondering about talking about the state of satire today and like how we reach people, who it reaches, if any of you had any thoughts on The Onion and Clickhole, because at least for like everybody I know, that's where they go to for satire.
I'll just tell
The Onion's very good, it's very funny, it's good humor. We had a show back in the 90s.
I guess
I know people like that. We read it that often.
They kind of got watered down.
Oh, okay.
Now it's watered down.
I read Street News.
Yeah. It was good.
Street News.
I'll just give you an example of satire. I drive a yellow cab and I was driving around with it. Now, when you come up with a crazy idea, the best thing is never call a lawyer. Because they're going to tell you, no, don't do it. If the idea is really crazy, you call Randy Credico. Because he will agree with it and then up the ante. So Bernie Madoff was being sentenced down on Worth Street. So I was driving around and I said, Randy, why don't we go down there and support Bernie Madoff and see what happens? So now we didn't realize what was going down on Worth Street. So I pick him up and of course we're so low rent we have cardboard and magic markers drawing up signs about free Bernie, free the Ponzi one. So we get down to Worth Street and there's literally hundreds of the world media of art there. So I said, all right, I take the yellow cab, I go into the parking lot right there. Randy and me come out, we go into the middle of Worth Street. Randy starts going, free Bernie Madoff, he's a first-time nonviolent offender, let him out on parole. The place went crazy, the media came down. So now we became financial analysts. And we started talking about, why are you here and not down on Wall Street? Bernie Madoff is one guy. He's not responsible for the financial breakdown.
He's the fall guy for the meltdown.
So Randy ends up on Argentinian television in pidgin Spanish explaining that I end up on
Spanish was better than Bloomberg.
Right. I end up on Al Jazeera speaking to the Middle East for 20 minutes and my philosophy of finance. So as we're going on giving interviews and holding up the signs, there's something called the law of unintended consequences. Randy and me didn't think this through because the victims started showing up. And these are people who lost everything. They were dumpster diving, they lost their houses, they were committing suicide. We didn't play that
in. Yes.
Well, there was other people too that lost their money. So as they started showing up, they were going absolutely crazy. And they started trying to charge us, as Randy's saying, release Bernie Madoff. And one guy frothing at the mouth, now we needed the police to protect the Bernie Madoff supporters. And one guy's going to me, what did you ever fucking lose to Bernie Madoff? Did he ever cost you anything? And I said, yes. I go into my pocket and I go, here, parking. I just parked my LK at $40 this parking just bought. He did not see the humor in this. At me. The cops come up to Randy and me and they said, I think it's time for your show to go on the road. Randy, you might think is crazy. He looked at me and said, it's time to go. But to have two working class guys go on worldwide TV and explain, why is Timmy Geithner in the cabinet? We said, Bernie Madoff, he might as well be there. He might give better advice than him. And why are you down there? And we were given such a role and airtime to explain our philosophy, which would never happen. Like, you would never be booked to say, listen, Randy.
Who would go on TV and say, I don't think a pro Bernie Madoff's name? You know,
it's just not going to happen. But that's one way of getting involved and getting your politics out on a stage that was waiting there.
We were slamming the bailout, we were slamming the TARP, all of that, and using this as a vehicle. There's no other way we were going to be heard. Until Occupy Wall Street came along 2 years later.
First of all, I think you're looking at things a little wrong. John Stewart, it's like instead of watching Fox, you just watch him and see what the news is.
But still misleading.
Well, no, I'm being, if I want to know what the issues are. And the thing is, you can't sometimes tell the difference between what's funny and what's real, which is very sad. Second of all, don't underestimate reformers. When my mom was a member of a very left-wing group in the 40s and 50s, the informer was the one who was the hardest working in the group because she kept the names of all the people and all the addresses.
We have three up in here right now.
the camera people. You know, you can, these days you don't have to have a big informer, you can just go there. You have to look and see what is the lowest common denominator and where people's heads are at. And the one thing I can come up with looking at all the candidates, and they are a sorry bunch, is pizza for president. I don't think anybody could dispute that. Just as smart and as efficient as any of these other people. And we could all vote. You could have any kind of topping you want. You could have it any time of day delivered to your house, which is better than any social justice.
Well, you said something to support about there are issues that seem to be one thing, but they're not. You need to peel the onion back. I believe there is something to be said for Charlie Hebdo, which is a my chance to be cool and pronounce it differently than Charlie. So Charlie Hebdo is one thing, and I believe there's a contingent to that. There's another part of it too. Yes, it was when somebody comes forward and says, what is this magazine? It'd be nice if you did some research because they do this. That's what they do. So all of a sudden somebody, because in America especially, you don't have to know anything about anything. All of a sudden you have an opinion and you're gonna start speaking and facts really mean nothing. Or you have another one. Then you have the Pamela Geller contingent to this. This is the artificial in order to create the meme that all Muslims are crazy and fanatical about their, like to put on a contest to see who can come up with the funniest satire. But that isn't satire.
what is the best stuff today, which I think people really get enough credit. When somebody goes onto Times Square and asks people, what's the EE? And nobody knows. I one time asked somebody, what's Labor Day, like the Union Square, the best place, nobody had any idea. Look, that satire or what? I think the Onion is so great, because if you did not know it was the Onion, and you really did, and you switched, and you read these, you would say, you know, that could very well be. Because today's news, cable media in particular, is a runaway train. If somebody with this train, you've got to break stuff off to throw it in the front and just keep this thing going. It doesn't really matter. And it does, if there's a duck playing the piano, something viral, the new cronut, somebody, the new Kim Kardashian, news Jenner, anything, just keep this thing going. So I don't think people realize the satire that's involved with people not knowing what's going on, because you're going to turn to an anchor and or anchors who also don't know what's going on. They're not going to say anything funny about not knowing what's going on, which is the inherent satire of the event to begin with. You cannot, remember, think about this way. In 50 years, local TV has not changed. News, sports, traffic, both has not changed. Traffic on TV to this day still confounds me more than Einstein's twin barrel. Who's watching traffic on TV in the car? It doesn't matter. It's feeding this thing. Just keep it going. Keep it going. Tweet us. Instagram us. Make us. Here's something. Something happened today. Oh, Joe Biden's been a sundial. Okay, move. Sad. Bob Cheever died. Okay, good. What really changed everything? This. This. Completely, whatever fluoride and water does to our brains, whatever. This changed everything. Because not only now are these people on stages not content with fooling and obfuscating reality by virtue of their news, they want to tweet you pictures as they're obscuring the news, and then you'll tweet them back, and it's this hodgepodge. And meanwhile, the ruling class, whoever runs this world, and Orwell, somewhere on some cloud, is saying, I never imagined it could be like this, because little brother has now beaten big brother hands down. We have been so, you want to find satire in the world? Great. Make your way through this mess. Try to get somebody's attention. Try to get somebody to stop doing this, to pay attention to this satire. Oh, wouldn't have a chance today. That magazine? Is it a tweet? Is it 140?
I actually think John Oliver is doing a really
really good job. Although I walk away from that show really mad because he does things like talk about how the police are confiscating people's stuff, talk about how big agriculture is poisoning us, you know, like, and he uses non sequitur to give a little bit of release, and then he goes back to the story. Hopefully he will continue to add something at the end that says, if you care about this, go get involved here. Because one thing I think about big, large platform humor is, and this is the thing about The Daily Show that always kind of killed me, there was never a call to action. He has this huge audience. I went to DC for that thing. It was a comedy show. He had this, you know, this
rally
like,
percentage.
Yeah, rally presented. I went.
All right.
Yeah. He had thousands of people on the wall, man. He could have.
Barry Crimmins would not ever be allowed to be on where John Oliver because he does call for action. It's much more incisive. It goes much further or farther, further down. What is it, farther, further?
Yeah.
Anything further, Father? Can't hear you. Yeah, maybe like a father.
Groucho Monkey.
Brother, Father?
But a guy like Barry Crimmins does, he mentioned him, Paul. He was supposed to be with us today, but we only had enough space for one person to do this. There's a documentary on him. The reason I'm bringing this up because it's in the program. You can see it's called Call Me Lucky. It will be at the BAM in July. It's in June. Barry went down to Nicaragua back in the 80s with me. I had a show called Humorous Against War. So we traveled through Nicaragua. You remember that, right, Mark?
Yeah.
We took five or six comedians down there and traveled. We even were up in Esteli doing a show. It rained. There was no roof in front of about 20 people from the U.S. who were picking coffee. And Crimmins is one of those guys that's basically given up his livelihood because he's dedicated to a real progressive, a radical agenda. And that's a real radical satirist.
Made it better. If Senator John McCain punched one of these guys with a reporter in the mouth and called him Sandinista shit and stomped out of his own press conference.
I paid for this microphone. Please let them move on. Yes. All right. Yes, sir.
So I just want to make one point in partial defense of John Stewart and The Daily Show. GAI can criticize right-wing politicians Fox News in a certain way and reach some people. MSNBC might do it in a slightly different way to reach some audience. The Nation could do it in a different way to reach some audience. But for those who are not reached by through any of those platforms or through any of those approaches, if Stewart comes on and satirizes a right-wing politician, or Fox News as dangerous and ridiculous in his own way, just as these other outlets are calling him dangerous and ridiculous in their way, and he reaches some additional people who weren't reached by any of the others, then at least it's serving some useful work.
I don't really get why people, like MSNBC, they spend half of their time and three quarters of their time hammering right-wing radio, right-wing television. Why do that? Because their audience isn't watching them. Start hammer Obama, hammer the bailout, hammer everything by this president and this administration. We don't need to listen to what Fox News, our criticism of Fox News. We know where they are. That's why I don't watch it. So I don't watch MSNBC because they spend 45 minutes criticizing them instead of giving us something that's critical of the current administration. After all, they're responsible for what's happening in Libya, they're responsible for what's happening in Syria, they're responsible for the expansion of the war in Afghanistan, the continuation of the mess in Iraq. And guess what? Rachel Maddow doesn't want you to know about that, so she's going to talk about Rush Limbaugh. I don't need that. And I don't need their other show, their flagship show, Lockup, that borderistic crap show. They should all leave that fucking station. It makes the most money for MSNBC. But MSNBC, NBC rots from the neck down like a chicken, starting with Chuck Todd all the way down.
Since Fox won't criticize itself, Somebody
who
has
cares?
To
They must, they're popular, they're entertainment. Look at it as entertainment. They have the right to do it, Charlie. Yeah, don't you like them? So,
I gotta say, what I agree with you. God bless John Stewart for how anybody
right.
who even makes something in the news hit, who makes somebody, some young person, some free voter or voter, or anybody for that matter, care. So absolutely, it's a start,
okay.
good, again, something other than this.
We're going to take another question. We're going to go to the, I want you to see this videotape that John looked down during the 2004 convention, was it?
And you're running down Fox along the show Fox.
All right, so John infiltrated Fox. If you hate Fox, let's show you what
well,
John
I,
did in 2004.
I just tell you, what we've been discussing today, you can see that if you're doing satire, you're not having a meeting about doing it. You heard Lionel said, he picked up the phone and did it. Randy Brunch-Forbes, Randy did not have a committee meeting to do it. Like, so, and you see what Paul Krasner going down to Wall Street, throwing the dollars off. Meetings are not going to do it. If an individual has an idea, you can make it work. You come up with the idea, you have to go out and don't wait for that magical meeting that's going to happen and that you'll be validated and say, you know what? I think that's a good idea. Let's take a vote. It's not going to happen. So you all remember George Bush invaded Iraq. It was another invasion. He invaded New York City.
We're fighting against the caters. America is fighting against the caters. We have to protect your freedom, a high freedom.
So when he was coming into New York for the Republican convention, I met with other fellow cab drivers and I said, let's do something against Bush coming to New York. So we organized a group called CAB, Cabbies Against Bush. And we went down to the convention and we handed out these coupons that if any Republican feels that urge to fight in Iraq, that we would drive to JFK. So I was handing them out down at the Garden. But then I was watching Fox Television and Bill O'Reilly. I do love watching Fox Television. I have to tell you, I love Bill O'Reilly, Sean Hannity, because I look at a subject and I say, how crazy can I make it? I can't compete with these guys because they go way over the top. So Bill O'Reilly's interviewing Michael Moore, and Michael Moore said to Bill O'Reilly, would you send your kid to Iraq? Bill O'Reilly says, no, but I would go. Now, here's a guy during Vietnam got deferments. So I organized a press conference down at the Foxhole on 6th Avenue. And I said, we got a couple of cab drivers. We said, open that foxhole up there. There's a Patriot. But obviously, you can't find Kennedy Airport. We're going to take him there. So I said, even if I had to put him in a headlock. So we had the press. They covered us. I go to walk in the front door. I said, you can't go in security. Go around to the mailbox, or they have a door where they deliver the mail and put it in his mailbox. So then I put that and I said, listen, give this to Sean Hannity. He might be feeling that pain for my nerve. So a couple of days later, a producer calls me and it's all this, like, this is what you wait for, Fox Television calling. And I would recommend that if you really want to watch Fox Television, go to their website, download their app, and watch it in the original German. Wait a minute. So, the producer calls me up and says to me, would you come on Neil Cavuto's show and talk about Republicans coming in about how they tip and about traffic? She says, can you do that? I said, I can talk about that. So they actually send a car out for me, town car, which was very nice. They bring me into the foxhole. I go down there, oh, it's wonderful. I'm all with all the fox heads all around there. Now, they were all doing interviews within the studio with Neil Cavuto, but when I came up, they brought me to another studio, so it looked like I was in Beirut. I had to wear an earpiece and look into the monitor for it. So I was supposed to be on for 5 minutes. Now, I knew what I was going to do, and I was a bit nervous, but I'll just show you how Fox does it. You have to look at the bottom ticker, because underneath it, it says, Osama bin Laden's driver has been arrested. We put two and two together, I'm there, Osama bin Laden's driver.
Hey,
yes.
I don't know if I heard Lyle correctly, but he was talking about John Stewart being a star. And that just
alive. Every modern...
Here goes the president of Greece.
There he is. Every modern beast, you had poor Jester.
Poor
Jester. Right, a necessary role. And I worry that these guys calculated, because I wrote for these people for a while, and wrote for descriptions. And I worry that these people take just enough gas or like steam out of the kettle so that the real questions aren't answered and the real revolution never starts.
It's only 1 minute 50 seconds, so my career at Fox Television is gone right now.
Welcome back, everyone. Well, you would think with thousands of delegates descending on Manhattan next week, the cabbies would be going gaga. They're not. Tom McDonough has been driving a cab in the Big Apple since 1977 and says that next week is going to be the biggest mess he's ever seen. So, John, you're not too psyched. Why not?
Well, because of all these so-called security precautions that are going around Manhattan and diverting the traffic everywhere, and I think Bloomberg is set up where some of the delegates will be able to come in from the airports for free. We just wish that they use some of the money that they have from the war profits from Halliburton and Bechtel and do a little trickle-down economy down to the cab drivers. We're organizing a protest against Republicans. We're asking cab drivers to turn their lights on and shine the light on Bush, and also passengers getting into the yellow taxis to ask the driver to turn on the headlights and do a protest for the 4 days that the Republicans are in town.
What if they already have daytime running lights anyway?
None of the cabs. There's 11,000 of them. They don't have the lights on. So if you do see a cab during those 4 days with the lights on, it'll be a protest. Probably in Iraq.
So there were no similar protests like this when the Democrats gathered in Boston.
I drive out of New York. I don't know what they were doing up in Boston, but this is what we're organizing here in New York City.
All right, John, would you pick up a Republican delegate if he or she needed a ride?
Oh, of course. And also, we're giving out a free coupon to anybody that wants to fight the war in Iraq. during a convention, we'll give them a free ride to the airport if they want to go to Baghdad and fight for my freedom.
Something wrong, so they're running after me. So I look like an Al Qaeda suspect with security running behind me. And sure enough, the cab, the black car was out there. I go jumping. I said, "Don't answer your cell phone. Get to the Midtown Tunnel." I said, "That's it." And that's the end of the story.
Drug charges by this ex-Klansman by the name of Tom Coleman. So we spent a lot of time down there. I got the New York Times there, the LA Times there, Time Magazine, tons of publicity. And so here it is, October 2003, and we're trying to get this case opened up. The woman that we brought in at that moment is now Obama's civil rights attorney, by the name of Benita Gupta. She had filed the briefs along with somebody else in Amarillo. So nothing's going anywhere. I do O'Reilly's show.
He asked me to go down there. I did the O'Reilly Show. He spends the first 20 minutes bashing Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton, right? And then the makeup of that, he puts me on. And when it was over, he says, I think this is a disgrace what's going on in Texas. And it went on and on and on and on. Within 2 days, they reopened the case. That's what influence he has down the Texas Court of Appeals. So that's the one good thing I know for sure that Bill O'Reilly has ever done in his lifetime. So other than that, I can't stand the guy. But that did happen with the influence that he had down there with that very reactionary Texas Court of Appeals. Yes?
Another question for Lionel. You were given a platform on mainstream media, Channel 11 in New York. I'm wondering how you got that gig, and whether they had script approval, and how the audience reacted. Did they react at all?
Well, they reacted very, very positively, and so did the New York Academy of Television Arts and Science by giving me an Emmy. The thing that I was the most proud of was in 2010, I remember the year, I was doing a piece and they let me do whatever I want to do, as long as I don't lose the license. And I stood up and I said, you see this? This is a place you'll hear about. It's called Benghazi. And that flag is Al-Qaeda over the courthouse. The rebels in Libya are Al-Qaeda. You hear kind of crickets, but nobody said no. They're sure enough, and people, we may laugh about the media mainstream, but Americans, people in general, love the truth. Once you give it to them and they hear it, I don't care who they are. Thank you.
He had to sit through a lot of sports and traffic and weather and all of that to get to his 4 minute spot, but it was worth it.
How did you come to get hired?
I don't know. How you lasted so long with your incredible point of view?
No, people, I just said, do you want to do a commentary? Yes. And you were very, very, it was as if we're the regime, so to speak. But it was absolutely true. And people love to hear something. The first time I said, there's a thing I want you to know about called GMOs. You mean with the insurance? I said, no. GMOs. Nobody heard of this. Nobody heard of it. Any of this, there was never, but people were saying, where do I learn about this? Again, don't ever underestimate
me. We're being joined by Daniela Walls, who's a scientist, big question for
you. Well, do you feel, I felt there were certain places that I couldn't go, there are certain things that are acceptable when you get to TV, like GMOs, that there are lines you can't cross, and that one big line are the bankers, Wall Street. And and I feel like there's a mechanism set up to protect Wall Street. So when you go there, they'll let you stay with certain issues that are like, I was a political satirist, and now I transitioned into, I'm the chair of a national political party, but because I felt that there was only so much I could do in the world of comedy.
Yeah, that's
boil
right.
Stuff down.
I'm gonna get to.
Yeah, you can only boil down stuff down into a 3 minute joke. So I needed to be able to say everything I need to say. So I transitioned into radio as well. And I think a lot of us had to make that transition because also, you're marginalized. You can't get on TV with this stuff. And you can't play in the big clubs. So you get marginalized. So I said, oh, okay, I'm having to perform with my own small, fan base in a gallery. Or in
a bookstore.
And it just wasn't reaching enough people, so I said I need to get to a place where it's there for posterity and it's on the air and people can listen to it. And it's not just a small group.
You got an internet show, right? What's it?
But by the way, just what people love the most that I did every night was on the Fed and Banker. They loved it. Absolutely. I said, in fact, what people love is when you do this. Say, don't take my word for it. Here is the art of, once you do that, once you say, okay, versus just an opinion, you say, I think derivatives pose a problem. Who are you? I am. Wall Street Journal says, oh. And it's weird because a lot of the stuff is already there, and people are going to die in here. I mean, there are some things you can't do, but it's not because of subject matter, it's style. in everything, whether it's cooking, sports. There's obviously things you don't want to, even in a comedy audience, you don't want to go beyond.
I have a master question. No, just a quick question to, in a general sense. When you talk about satire and political stuff, like the nature of funny, the nature of what makes, and each of you briefly.
It's such a difficult question to ask and answer. Read that book, Analysis of a Joke by Freud. Right? It'll take you about 6 years to finish it. But it's the most boring subject trying to analyze comedy. It is, you know, if you laugh, it's fun. If you don't laugh, it's not funny. But it doesn't happen. If that's what it abuses you, that's fine too. You again.
You did the wake for Margaret Thatcher. Here's a good satire opportunity. Yesterday was announced in Britain that they're going to have an anti-Thatcher museum in response to a pro-Thatcher museum to celebrate the life and works of Margaret Thatcher that the Tories had already established.
He's so, the curator.
The opportunities for satire for Ronald Reagan, who of course has been made into a god in many circles in this country, are enormous. We probably cost too much to build the museum, but we could do a lot on the internet.
So even with Ronald Reagan, I mean, there's an airport named after him. I don't know how many people you would get there, but there was something about Thatcher. Like a lot of political figures that when I said we're going to have the wake, everybody was in on it. Like the musicians, poets, comedians. Like Randy dressed up as Ronald Reagan.
Mike Carey, along
with Satan. To welcome her into hell.
And I was a Satan mask on one side, and I was on this side.
And we had the coffin outside of Rocky Sullivan's and carried it into the bar where we were all getting loaded. And Randy gets up, and he started talking about how, as Ronald Reagan, he got there by taking the IKEA boat over to Redwood. And that's how he travels now. And how he had the prison all nice and dusted, and he was waiting for Maggie. But the one guy he was really waiting for was Henry Kissinger. And he says, we have a special room, but he won't die. He keeps renewing his contract. And he won't come down there. But
he's 800 years old now, Kissinger.
There was something about Thatcher that got everyone going. I don't know if Ronald Reagan, but there's so many on the right just love him. I mean, like, he is just...
Lionel, I just wanted to see if you're ever able to talk about the New York State stock transfer tax at any time in the show.
Oh, that brings down the crowd all the time.
700 votes being on that part.
But I will tell you this much. Wall Street sales tax, Tobin tax, Robin Hood tax, when people hear this, when people don't realize that that's there, I don't know if it's funny, but they will automatically say, why didn't I hear about it?
Right.
Why didn't I know about it? Or the tax Wall Street part. When Bernie Sanders talks about, I don't pay income inequality. What are you going to do, Bernie? The inequality. What about the Wall Street sales tax? What about raising the tax? What about that? So I'm not sure if it's satire, but I guarantee you, I've never met anybody who didn't say, you mean these trades aren't taxed? They're not at all?
The interesting thing, though, is that actually New York has the tax on the books, and it's...
We don't go by rule of law anymore. I don't know.
There's a lot of panels left about the tax Wall Street party.
I think
you got to get to before this is over. So, is that being a platform for humor, I think the answer is who's next?
Yeah. Juliana made a comment a few minutes ago about satire putting up a mirror in front of reality. And I just want to get the opinion of the panel in terms of
the effectiveness of informed impersonation, like David Fry used to do with Nixon and Kissinger and that kind of thing.
We're
just
here. Perfectly.
Well, I like to watch the Jimmy Dore show. It's on at 3 o'clock in the morning on WBAI because we haven't had the foresight to have the balls to put it on, and that's why. My understanding is, and he's a personal friend of mine, but he has a lot of call-ins, these false call-ins, and what he says is the left doesn't understand satire, and then he has a very angry leftist call in a fake one, saying like, I didn't like your impression of Bill O'Reilly, and I didn't think when you had this guy on, So they don't go over all that well with the WBAI audience. I can't speak outside of that. Randy can probably, because he's a professional at that.
Okay.
Randy probably gets the most flack for doing Al Sharpton. For whatever reason, when Randy brings in Al Sharpton, we take phone calls at BAI. Come on, man, why are you doing that?
And you know, the Sharpton is not here for this conference. And the reason why he's not here, clearly, because there's not enough money for him. And that would be the driving force. He is the Billy Graham to the Democratic Party. That's what he is. And no one should take him seriously as an NBC plaque, along with those other five guys who should be working out of the Oval Office on MSNBC. So Sharpton had known for a long time, ex-FBI agent. Of course I'm going to slam the guy. He infiltrates movements. He doesn't organize. He doesn't really. He's got Eric Holder as this guy, you know. He likes Obama. He likes to be close to power. He's an easy guy to slam. But there are a lot of people think that it's racist for me to slam Al Sharpton. I did a joke one time that got me killed. They said about Jesse Jackson when he said, "I held Martin in my arms when he lied dying. But you were on the fifth floor. I have a long reach."
I write song parodies, okay? Back in 2008, I did an hour's worth of stuff. All the voices, unfortunately, were mine, and I sang my own lyrics to a bunch of oldies, which included things like From a Schmuck to a King, an old country song about how W got into office, and good things like that. I did something like that in 12. I had Palin singing about how they're going to stuff the ballot boxes, and Chelsea Manning singing from her cell. And people are begging me to do another one of these next year. And I'm like, the Republicans have like 800 candidates, or is it 8,000 now? What am I supposed to do with that? I don't have enough songs. And things have gotten so rotten that I thought, in the tradition of Tom Lehrer, and oh my God, that guy upstate, Mark, what's his name, from Buffalo. I thought, maybe I'll just retire and cite him. Things have gotten so lousy that I can't do it.
Abe Lincoln is the only Republican not running.
Guys, you've convinced me. I have to dig up 20 more old songs and write
new ones. Go ahead.
Yes. So, thank you.
Yeah, Harvard. Yeah.
I spent the last decade as delegate with the missile dictators.
Yeah.
I was delegate. So the political satire group, they pretended they were pro-war and pro-Bush, and they were singing and dancing funny, funny songs, dressed in red, white, and blue, wearing a 2-foot-long papier-mâché strap-on penises that looked like cruise missiles. They were the missile dictators. They were crazy, and I had a great Bush next door. Anyway, I was curious about the limitations of corporate media on Stewart, you work for Stewart, and how does that actually function? I know they won't talk about the system ever, but how does that?
He is a chosen satirist. They wouldn't let a guy like Diogenes on these days. They wouldn't let Paul Krasner on in his prime right now in that spot. You know, he is better. He's self-censoring. There's only so many things you can do in that position. When you got Ford, and you got Chrysler, and you got USBC, all of these different huge corporations financing it. So he just knows not to go there. He gets stuff out.
He knows not to go there.
I mean, he does cross the line, I guess. I've never seen the show. So I'm just taking it on his word.
I love the John Stewart Show, and he has influences on my three kids who are now politicized because of John Stewart, and they take it to the next level and read a bit more. He has great guests that come on. So I just think John Stewart, who's God sent, after a long day of work, you tune him in, and he's taking the piss out of everything. And, you know, I just thought, you know, he's going to be missed. How the new guys do it, I don't know, but... John Stewart had an influence on particularly college kids.
College,
they're all watching it, and now that you can go to the Huffington Post and get the 3-minute clip that was the funniest, and you just click on that and you watch the topic that he was covering.
So we're not lockstep here about John Stewart. No.
Well, it was a comment that I said above where he knows the boundaries to stay within. I think he's conscious of those boundaries. And he knows not to go after the elephant in the room, which are managers. And if you don't transition into making fun of him, what? Yeah, right, and his only brother is the head of the New York Stock Exchange. He's very conscious of his role, and he plays an important part in keeping this system together. It's to make fun of things that aren't threatening. And he goes to the edge, but he doesn't let it go over to the point where people are going to get organized, and he's not putting out...
It was a non-union show for 10 years. He fired a lot of people.
I agree with what you said earlier about... letting some of the steam out. And I think the same is true. I don't think any of us should be watching or supporting MSNBC, because as far as I can see, it's just the Democratic Party's TV station.
And who are they the party? The same as the
Democrats. Yeah, and they're making big money, and they're, you know, showing commercials, and all they're going to do, you know, you were saying, Randy, how come you're not talking about Obama? How come?
They want to talk about O'Reilly.
He's their god. No, they're not going to talk about
O'Reilly. They want to talk about O'Reilly. They don't have to talk about Obama.
They're going to talk about
It's Comcast. We'll do it.
This gentleman asked what the boundaries are, and the boundaries are finance oligarchy. That's the boundary. If you're not fighting bankers, you're spinning your wheels.
There's the war machine. And there's a lot of things you're not going to talk about. All right, a lot of things that he's not going to talk about. He didn't say anything about criminal justice until after Ferguson. He spent 13 years not bringing it up. Go ahead.
If it's not funny, if people tune out, if you say, I'm going to do a great thing tonight for the $5 quadrillion derivative bubble, and if I have to start, as you said, explaining this, and if I don't get a laugh, I'm through.
Right.
Not because the subject matter is off limits, but because maybe I'm not that good at making certain things like that funny. But here's the good news. That is mainstream media. That is usual content. Right now, with the burgeoning world of multiple platforms and delivery systems and content, you're going to see people who come out of nowhere, who carry an audience that these people can only dream of anytime. And that's the thing. So one thing about John Oliver. John Oliver did a piece. He could do something with banking if he wanted. He did something about payday loans. Now, if I said, is there anything funny about payday loans? Probably not. He did. Reason why is they gave him enough time. And they let him do whatever he wanted to do because he was passionate. They didn't give him a minute 30 and say, quick, wrap it up. Let's go. We got news for you. Mother going to give it up. He did it. He actually did it. So I agree. Anything can be hysterical funny if you're allowed to. And that's your job as an entertainer. To translate. But in 5 years, maybe sooner, you won't recognize the entertainment delivery system like you do. You won't recognize it. There will be people somewhere on a YouTube channel who are getting 20, 30, 40 million hits a day. And people are going to say, we want you to come on mainstream. And they'll say, no, that's not big enough. That's going to happen. It's happening right now.
Well, this has been a really big show.